Hello friends, so we are now discussing, this is our last but one class on post-colonial writings. This is the 9th lecture. We have so far seen different models. We saw the special characteristics of post-colonial writings and the theoretical basis, etc. we saw. Now, the next point is that we should give it a name, finding a name. Very simple, you can call it whatever you want, as Shakespeare said, no? Finding a name. That's important, no? Yes. So that is the next item to see. The next lecture, so to say. Ninth. Finding a name. So Shakespeare said like this, no? What is there in a name? A rose would smell sweet even if it is called by some other name. Isn't it? Yeah. So, but here he says, you can see there is a half a dozen plus one name suggestions. And finally, we have selected, not we, but those people who were researching or exploring the post-colonial writings, they came upon a name that is by consensus they call it post-colonial writings. Of course, there are some reasons for that, as you can see. The first name suggested is Terra Anglia. First name is, I can say like this, Terra Anglia. Anglia, you know, English. Terra means earth. Terra. You know, we have got the word terrestrial. We are terrestrial beings and angels are celestial beings. Heavenly. Celestial beings. So, terra means land or earth. So, Terra Anglia means all the writings in English on this earth. That is the meaning. All the writings in English on this earth. But this is suggested by Joseph Jones. That is the suggestion by Joseph Jones. So the meaning, you got the meaning. This Terra Anglia means writings, all the writings in English throughout the world. But that is not accepted. As we can see, post-colonial literature is not only in English, but also in native language. That also we say, we can call them or group them under post-colonial literature. So that is not accepted. Alright, the next one was, second is Commonwealth literature. You know, Commonwealth is a group of nations, there's a grouping, which were once colonies of Britain, Great Britain. And then what happens is that America will be out. So that is the situation. So they don't. So that is, in fact, then it's a geographical and political limitation it has got. Geographical and political. The basis actually is a shared history and the political grouping is based on that, a shared history. That means they were the colonies of the England, colonies of Britain. Listen, it's just a collection of national literatures. You don't have all these other countries now. Means, see, for example, you cannot include America. America is not a member of the Commonwealth. Right? So there are such ones. Some days what happens is, for some day they will be members of Commonwealth and then they will withdraw. Like for example Pakistan, for some day they withdrew their membership. They resigned. So we are not interested in this. You remember that, no? That's in history. It's not real. So the basis is they are united, you can say they are united by a past and a present membership of the British Commonwealth. So it depends on the British Queen, the pressure of the British Queen. If the British Queen wants or does not hold pressure, then she can say this particular country should be removed. That has never happened, but very often it happens that they themselves withdraw. I told you in the case of so. See, that is so common, but the literature is out. And then the third suggestion was third world liberalism. Third world liberalism. Third world means not first world. First world is Europe. And this is third world liberalism. There is a problem with the discrimination is there. First world, second world, then third world. So that also, and it doesn't in any way suggest the colonial past, the colonial connections. So that is also rejected, not accepted. And then you can see now, you probably might have seen this. Another suggestion was this new literatures, fourth one. New literatures. So that means here, there again, there is no suggestion of colony and colonization. Right? And immediately what you will think is that you will think of contrasting it with the old literature. Nothing to do with colonial literature, but old literature. Oh, this is new, the other one is old. Say the English literature, say up to the 19th century, you will say old. Not acceptable. We don't bust that. And then we have got another one, what is called, colonial literatures. There is another one, colonial literatures. Then here there is another problem is there. What is that? Colonial literatures means only literatures produced during the occupation. That is again restricted. All these names, finding a name, it's not that easy, isn't it? Yeah. Because you have to bring together all these ideas now. Yes. Then what happens is then another is, see, post-European. Sixth one is post-European. Suggested by Dorsenville. Post-European. And that again, what does that mean? That means after withdrawal of the Europeans. But before that also they started writing. So during conversation also. See? So finally they agreed upon this word, this post-colonial literatures, this one. This is agreed upon. That is post. So the name that everybody has agreed upon is post-colonial literatures. So what does that mean again? Post-colonial. So it has got all the aspects, no, of literatures. So it could mean post-colonial means there was once upon a time it was a colony, then now it is not a colony, now it is an independent country, and now as a result of this colonization there might have been syncretic and hybrid elements in that literature. Then, since it was, these countries were colonies, the theoretical base, the epistemology, for example, that was supplied by all European influence, there must have been. And the colonization also is a historical reality. It also focuses on the relationship which has provided creative and psychological impetus for writing. So this relationship has, like Wilson Harris, for example, or H.B. So such people, what do? They give some kind of some credit to colonization, this process of colonization. That is, you came into contact with a, you can say, a higher culture, say that, and there was mixing, and they learned a new language, a global language, for example. This all gave psychological impetus in writing. So that is. And again, you can say, European theories were the basis. You saw now that the critical theories, the critical input was given by European theories like structuralism, post-structuralism, modernism, almost the same. Then you have feminism, Marxist criticism. Understand, these are European theories. So we found that most of the colonial, the post-colonial literature is analyzed based on this. So they are studying now, exploring post-colonial literature based on these theories. For example, Spivak says, you know, remember one of our lectures, Mr. Spivak says, that is Gayatri Spivak says that the relationship between man and woman can be compared to the European powers or imperial powers. Yes, the empire and the colonies. Empire is man and colonies women, you can say like that. So there can be then feminist approach will be just said that you can assert your superiority as in this case of man-woman relationship. Feminists they stand for that. So that we also can see. Therefore, you see, and it is less restrictive. It takes into account the historical reality, it takes into account the European contribution, it takes into account the energy supplied by this creativity and the psychological power supplied by this European connection, isn't it? You cannot deny that, although imperial we say, hegemony we say, but still there is some kind of positive influence also, we cannot deny that. So, considering all this, the syncretic nature, the hybrid nature of post-colonial literature. So, all these points, if you take into consideration, post-colonial can be accepted as a name that could be approved by all. So, you have got six suggestions, and then we have taken the seventh one, that is the post-colonial literature. And for reasons, there are reasons for that, no? We have a historical fact, it's a reality, yes. So if you take like this, once again, Terra Anglia. Yes, you cannot say all of the writings on earth is, you cannot call it, is, there is no suggestion of calling. Another way. Commonwealth, it's a limited group. Third world, discrimination. New literature, means new and old. Colonial literature, but before, after that also they were writing. And also, another thing, native writing. Suppose, during the time of colonization, for example, if somebody is writing in Indian language here, that's also post-colonial literature, or colonial literature, yes. So that you can say, all Europeans writing about colonies. So that's also colonial literature, post-colonial literature, yes. So post-European, not at all accepted. And finally, we come to post-colonial literatures. I think it's clear to you now. So that's why we say that. So what are the special characteristics of, special characters of post-colonial literature that we have seen in our first lecture, isn't it? That's the reason why we accept this name also. Hope that you have followed me. There's nothing to follow here. Well, some names are there. Some names are rejected. Finally, we accept one name. Because it tells you about the historical reality, it tells you about the strength that the colonies received, it tells you about the imperial connection and its after effect, it tells you about the European theories, dependence on European, or not dependence, but the input supplied by European theories, isn't it? And it also tells you that what we must say that it is less restrictive. It is inclusive, not exclusive or restrictive. Therefore, we accept post-colonial as. Sometimes you may get questions like this in the university exams. Why do you call it post-colonial literature? Why don't you say pre-colonial literature? Why don't you say this colonial literature? The reason we have already seen. I hope that I have justified the suggestions given by these people, and finally we have come to the conclusion that post-colonial is accepted and that is justified. I think so. So, I hope that you are enjoying my lectures, and if you are enjoying, definitely you should also share your enjoyment with your other fellow students. Understand that? As I said, no? Hamlet calls Horatio his fellow student. Do not mock me, fellow student. Yes. So, in case I make any mistakes now in my lectures, or if you find some improvement is required, don't feel shy. Tell me directly, bluntly on my face. You can visit my site here, englishforme.in, and then you will get all the details, how to contact me and so on. You contact me and definitely I am open to your criticism and open to any suggestions given to me. So we'll have just one more lecture before we wind up, and soon we will be taking up the next theoretical approach to colonialism, and that is Homi K. Bhabha's mimicry and the man. Mimicry, you know, that is, it's a very important topic in post-colonial theory and discussions that we will take up immediately after this. Okay, so tomorrow we will be doing thematic parallels, and then we'll pass on to the, that will be about how many lectures? Today is 9th and tomorrow 10th. So 10 lectures, that's good. I think they have covered almost all the aspects of this, as well as a university level knowledge or university level scholarship is required.
Yeah.
Not a research. These are not research lectures or papers. These are mere lectures for helping students doing PG. Understand that? I hope that every university has got this paper, and the Empire, Literature and the Empire. Okay. So we'll be covering the entire paper. Don't worry. If you have got any doubts in between, as I told you, you visit my site and then contact me. Alright? So till then, bye-bye.